Good morning, Zion. You belong here. We belong together. Today we are celebrating the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. And I have good news. We are once again hosting live in-person corporate worship. The painting is done, the carpet is laid, the hard floors are laid, the pews are back, and everything looks beautiful. I can't wait for you to see it. And I'm so excited that this weekend we will once again have members and visitors worshiping in this house of worship. If you're considering joining us for live in-person corporate worship, then I would encourage you to go to our website, zionohio.org, where you can learn more about all the conditions that must be met and maintained while we are in the building. Worship during pandemic is certainly weird, but God is still good and worthy of our praise. Our services are 5 o'clock on Saturday evening. That's a blended service. And then Sunday morning at 9:30 is our traditional Lutheran liturgical worship service. By the way of announcements, last week the Northeastern Ohio Synod Assembly was held and we elected a new bishop, the Reverend Dr. Laura Barbins. Please keep her and her family in your prayers as she prepares to take office. Also last Saturday, we hosted our second annual God's Work Our Hands Day cleanup of Kornersburg. And while the participation was less than we had hoped for, our thanks to all those who showed up to do that good work. Last Thursday, we hosted our first What's Cooking at Zion drive-through turkey dinner since the pandemic shut us down. All the proceeds from that meal go to debt reduction. You want to know what you did? You sent other members of our church out to deliver something like 30 meals to our members as a token of our love and appreciation for their faithfulness. Yeah, you should have heard some of the responses I got when I called them to tell them that dinner was on us. And the drivers were thankful to do it. Thank all of you for your generosity. I think we'll do it again in October. Food distribution was also this last Saturday. My thanks to all of you who participated in that. Our next Red Cross blood drawing will be this Thursday, September the 24th from 1 to 6 p.m. And as I always say, for your convenience, I would encourage you to schedule your donation by calling 1-800-RED-CROSS or by going to the redcrossblood.org website and entering the keyword Zion Canfield or by searching any local blood drawing that is convenient for you. For more information about any of the activities that are going on in and around your church, I would once again refer you to the website zionohio.org where you can find out all the information. If you wish to receive the weekly edition of Eye on Zion, our weekly newsletter, or My Daily Devotion, the Daily Word, or the occasional word, our occasional announcements, emails, then please go to the website zionohio.org and go to the bottom right corner and click on the subscribe button where you will have several options to select. I want to thank you for your continued financial support. To make an offering, we suggest once again the Zion Ohio website where you can click on the Give tab or the Give Plus smartphone app from your app store. Or you can text to give, just text this number, 833-409-0694, and then in the body itself, text the word assist and follow the prompts. You can also still reach us by the U.S. mail. Assisting in worship today are, of course, Joan Gent, our administrator of worship and music on the keyboards, who is now celebrating her 31st year of service right here to us at Zion, and Michelle Vargo, who will be leading us in our singing and providing special music, and Carrie Huff will be leading us in our prayers of intercession. Now I invite you to join in singing our gathering song.
Cards that cannot.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. A reading from Jonah. When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give him shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You were concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay whatever is right.' So they went out. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing idle here all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am not I allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The Gospel of the Lord. The Gospel reading for today is an example of the radical generosity of God, which would have been a great sermon title, but no, I chose How Much Does God Love Me? You see, I was being cute. For the first weekend in September, the sermon was entitled How Much Do You Love Me? Part 1, and I preached about the responsibility for behavior within the fellowship of the faith. And I pointed out that it is the responsibility of the one offended to point out the offense to the offender. That in that sermon, I asked you, the fellowship of the faithful, if you loved me enough, or another member of the fellowship, enough to come to me or them with an offense so that there is a chance to reconcile the relationship. And then last week, in a sermon entitled How Much Do You Love Me? Part 2, I preached a sermon about the abundant grace of God when Peter asked the Lord just how many times must he forgive the sins of another against him. Remember, Peter threw out a crazy number like 7, thinking that to forgive someone 7 times was just crazy. I mean, there ought to be limits, yes? But Jesus replied that we must forgive not 7, but 77 times. As far as that sermon title goes, How Much Do You Love Me? Part 2, it must go a long way if you're going to have to forgive me or someone else 77 times. Well, this week we're going to hear about the radical generosity of God, and now that I think about it, that would have been a great sermon title, but alas, How Much Does God Love Me is what the sermon title is that God gave me back in the middle of August, and so there it is. God gave it to me and we're stuck with it. The gospel reading contains a story of God's radical generosity. And speaking for all of us, it's just not fair. We are all hardworking Americans, and we just don't think it's fair that everyone, the one who works in the heat of the day all day, and the one who just stumbles onto the job site in the last hour of the day, gets paid the same. Why, it's un-American. As a former manufacturing plant manager, this kind of thing is inviting trouble with the union. So, let's take a look at the first reading. The Ninevites were the ancient enemies of the Hebrew people. Jonah, as a prophet of the Hebrews, sincerely hoped, maybe even prayed, for the destruction of the Ninevites. But you see, God created all people, those who are God followers and those who worship stone idols. And so God told Jonah to go to the Ninevites and preach a word of repentance to the Ninevites. In fact, what God told Jonah to tell the Ninevites was that they needed to repent or face annihilation. Jonah didn't want to give that message. He wanted God to wipe out the Ninevites. So he headed in the opposite direction, got swallowed up by a whale, then got spit up on the shore, and that finally gave him the idea that maybe he ought to be obedient to God's word. And so he went to Nineveh, and he walked to the center of the town, and he delivered that message that God wanted him to deliver. He said, repent, or God's going to wipe you out. Did you hear that? No? I'll say it again. Repent, or God's going to wipe you out. Did you hear it that time? Still no? Well, you know what? Jonah didn't want the Ninevites to hear it either. That's right. He didn't even really want to express the message. But you know what? The king of Nineveh heard it nevertheless. And so he and the whole nation repented. Dang it, thought Jonah. Now God's not going to wipe out those blankety-blank Ninevites. And so Jonah went out into the wilderness and pouted. The first reading is his coming to terms that God is the God of all. Geez, now that I think about it, this reading is a lot like the gospel reading, isn't it? A lesson about the differences between our human understanding of what's right and good and the radical generosity of God. Lest you think that these stories are just biblical platitudes from antiquity to give us something to ponder, but no real-time relevance, let me remind you of some of the issues that were brought up by the Democrat candidates for the party nomination. And then there is, of course, the prevailing Republican response. Free college tuition for all and student loan forgiveness. What? Wait, that isn't fair. I paid all my student loans back. Increase the minimum wage to a life-sustaining wage. What? That's crazy. It's supposed to be a minimum wage. Full health care for all. What? Who's gonna pay for that? More money coming out of my paycheck to take care of people who haven't taken care of their own business. Open borders. Are you kidding me? Those freeloading, no good Mexicans are going to come in and take our jobs and use up all our social resources. Well, you and I will get to decide this November, and because we live in a democratic country, a majority vote will determine who the president will be and who the majority in the House and the Senate will be, and together that will determine the outcome of all these issues. Or not. We'll have to wait and see. It is not this way all around the world, however. But in our country, there is the separation of church and state, a protection written into the Constitution as the First Amendment that was written to protect religion from the state and not the other way around, as it is so often used. For better or worse, in this country, we have religious freedom, which also includes freedom from religion. Citizens of our country can worship the God of their belief as they please, or not worship any God at all. A religious belief system is a choice guaranteed under our Constitution. Let's be clear. Throughout Scripture, Jesus never spoke to the Roman authorities until his trial. Jesus was always ministering to and speaking to the Jews or people of other religions like the Samaritans, people who were powerless to enact any institutional change. But that does not mean that his teachings had no impact. On the contrary, Jesus Christ and his teachings are felt everywhere. One little example. The biggest health system in our area is Mercy Health, founded by the Catholic Church. In Fort Wayne, Indiana, where I'm from, the two biggest hospitals in the community are the Lutheran Hospital and the Methodist Hospital. Christians have always been at the forefront of bringing mercy and wholeness. Another example, arguably, some of the best institutions of higher learning were formed by religious bodies. Harvard and Yale, for example, were founded by the Congregationalists. Princeton was founded by the Presbyterians. Notre Dame was founded by the Catholics. The best known Lutheran university is probably Valparaiso, but there are several. And I'm pretty sure that I'm right about this. The Ten Commandments are the first written code of law in human history and the basis of every written code of law since. But I digress. The point that I am making is that Christians do not need to and should not rely on the government to do what we are called to do. And that is, arguably, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. For example, our nation right now is facing two major disasters, the wildfires on the West Coast and the repeated hurricanes and tropical storms in the South. FEMA will do what it will, but the Red Cross, the Salvation Army, and Lutheran Disaster Relief, among others, will be the first ones on the scene and the last ones to leave. And they do it all with the generous donations of Christians and other folks. The same is said for the mercy shown to immigrants and refugees here and around the world. It is often religious institutions and private institutions that are the first to on the scene and the last to leave. Frankly, on those several issues I mentioned several minutes ago, I don't care what your political opinion on them is. We can disagree as fellow citizens of this great country, but what we as Christians cannot disagree about is the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. In this week's readings, we have examples of that. Jonah did not get to decide whom God loved. God loved the Ninevites and wanted them to straighten up. I'm pretty sure that in our day, God loves the radical Muslims that terrorize the world and the radical Christians who blow up abortion clinics. I believe that God hates how they abuse his word and justify their evil actions, but God still loves them. And I believe that God wants us to save all that God has created for eternity. And if that means one comes to faith on their deathbed and another like me has been a Christian for a lifetime, then who am I to cry, that's not fair? I'm not God. And when in my soberer moments I think about it, I, like all, have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I am as lost at saving myself as the homeless town drunk asleep on the park bench. But thanks to God, God loves us all and sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to save us from ourselves. Some of us from our sinfulness and some of us from our self-righteousness. You decide which one you are. But know this. The answer to the question, which is the title of my sermon, How Much Does God Love Me?, was answered on the cross of Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago when he spread his arms far and wide to embrace the whole world with his love. About this salvation that Jesus brought, the Apostle Paul wrote, "This is God's doing." And with that in mind, we ought to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God, recognizing that any suffering we incur boasting in Christ Jesus for the honor of serving those God loves, in Jesus' name. Join me in a prayer. Lord Jesus, forgive us when we try to move you and your Holy Father aside and take over. Thank you for this holy house of worship and for your word and for your love, grace, and mercy. After being closed for 2 weeks, we so need to gather and hear your words of gospel and forgiveness and gather around this altar and taste and see your love for us in this meal. Forgive us for our arrogance and receive us humbly. We pray this in your holy name.
Love for one like me. this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very room. And in this very room, there's quite enough love for all of us. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all of us. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very room. And in this very room, there's quite enough love for all the world. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all the world. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very
we have been made God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Drawn together by the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need.
O God, you make the last first and the first last. Give resources and courage to the churches around the globe that have few resources. When ministry in this time is so difficult, inspire bishops, pastors, deacons, and congressional leaders in their service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Continue your care for your whole creation, sun and wind, bushes and worms, cities and farms, and all your many animals. Make us into extensions of your care. Preserve the food sources of the world's endangered wildlife. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. To places of conflict and violence, bring peace, especially to the cities of our nation. Bless the work of negotiators, peacekeepers, and development workers. Preserve protesters and guide police. Enlighten our nation, the nations we call friends, and the nations that are deemed our enemies. Keep our election season from dishonesty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give your blessing to the Jewish people at this time of their new year. Bring an end to anti-Semitism around the globe and strengthen peace efforts in the Middle East. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. To all who are suffering, show your mercy. We pray for firefighters, for communities devastated by fire, for all who suffer racial injustice, for migrants who seek safety, for all who are imprisoned, for victims of crime, for the unemployed, for students and faculty during the pandemic, for medical workers, for all who are hungry. O God, the list of the needy is so long. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give health and wholeness to all who are sick, to all who are suffering from the coronavirus, and especially to those on our prayer list, our homebound, and those we now name before you, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise you for all the saints, especially Randy Bergoglio. Give us grace to live for Christ until we join with all the faithful in your eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have set before us these gifts of your good creation. Prepare us for your heavenly banquet. Nourish us with this rich food and drink, and send us forth to set tables in the midst of a suffering world. Through the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now please join in singing our sending hymn. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine on us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. Amen. You belong here. We belong together. Go in peace. Remember the poor. Thanks be to God.